Making a life worth living and retirement worth having is really about who we have in our lives. The reality is that the people in our lives, the networking contacts we have, and the social skills that we bring to those relationships help us produce a better life. There's all types of people in this land. There are people who have just a few friends and they're deep, powerful, passionate, healthy, regardful relationships. Then there are people who sort of skim the earth. They practically make friends with every single person they meet. And then when it's time, they vie into those lives and say, hey, I met you at such and such, and I'm looking for employment. Would you mind helping me? Then there's a whole bunch of folks in between with all different gamuts. They run in all different circles of life, and they're literally looking for, how do I make a life? And how do I keep my life? And how do I keep my home? And how do I keep paying my bills and my mortgage and my car payments and food on the table and literally the shelter and roof over our heads in the cold or in the heat? When I'm talking about homelessness, I'm talking about it firsthand because never in my wildest dreams did I ever expect to be homeless. I am a person who has a mind. I was always taught to utilize that mind to produce for myself a job, a business, or some other entity of programming that allowed me to get paid a reasonable wage to care for my home and care for my life and pay my bills. I think there was only a few months of struggle when clients chose not to pay me that I wasn't able to pay a few car payments on occasion. Those clients were not apologetic at all in the fact that they didn't produce the check on time. Things like that happen in life, and they thought that they could just say, well, I can't afford it, so I'm not going to do it right now. And that really isn't lawful based on the agreements that were in place. But when I talk about lawfulness, we have to look at what is the lawful right thing to do for people who are homeless. You see, there are a lot of people in the community that don't get homelessness at all because they're not thinking at all about their future. I'm not sure where people think their retirement is going to come from if they're not setting money aside, and quite a bit of money, or liquidating assets like stocks, bonds, and actually a house in order to make sure they have a retirement. You see, people buy houses to live in for them a long time. The question is, do they get them fully paid off by the time they have to move, downsize, and go to retirement homes? Or to individualized apartments, something that's on one floor where the actual apparatuses and the appliances are at a lower level for easier access and use? And will they have all the mechanisms they need to keep them safe, like fire detectors and things? Because sometimes we get busy, we put something on the stove, we walk away, and poof, we've got a little blaze afloat. Now, when I'm talking about real life, I'm talking about it as a man who's approaching 50 this year. It's sort of a shock to me that I've lived for 5 times of 10 years of life, but the reality is it's true. When I look back on my life and what I produced in terms of business, starting a business at first at age 15, literally bringing people into a made-up photo studio where lights were attached to ladders and other aspects of the ceiling of the basement in order to produce a full-fledged studio, but the good news was my father worked for General Electric, who do bring good things to life, and he knew how to light a studio. He gave me bulbs from his work. He purchased them, I'm sure, and it worked out fine. I began my first photographic studio back then. But from then on, I continued to work. I continued to work at retail jobs or in ways that allowed me to produce some life. It wasn't until much later that I realized how to produce a really sophisticated life, where I was working in limited hours of the week and producing a life to care for 3 people, my family, my own family, not my birth family. But then there was a moment in time where loss came in. And when loss came in, I wasn't fully prepared for that full loss. And when that loss came in, I would have expected friends who I'd made deep relationships with would have come around and sort of helped, or business colleagues who knew that that was a really important relationship to me might have said, hey, let's lend a helping hand and make sure he still has business going. None of them did that. So when you think you've got these relationships that you've served for years in different networking forums and other ways of bringing people in to help them meet new people, etc., or bringing in educational value, that's not always the case. I can remember one time when a man said that he paid for something and he ended up getting 2 of them. And I thought, wow, that's great, but what did you do with the second one? Did you donate to someone else? Did you give to someone in need? But it wasn't really my lawful right to say. You see, those in need are usually those who have needs indeed. And what I mean by that is that for a person who's homeless, they're looking mainly for the 3 things that they need to have in life. They're looking for shelter to stay out of the storm and the rain. I literally had a shelter the other night that was wonderful. Someone literally gave me a blanket because mine had been stolen from me by some of the people who've been stalking my life. And openly, my great wool blanket and my drop cloth that I would sleep on to keep the chill of the earth off my bones was removed from me, along with a bunch of other things in that bag that were sort of important to me, especially hats that were gifted to me by my father and other aspects of his heritage in the military. A military hat that was bequeathed to me from his work in the Air Force was stolen within that bag, along with a dragon hat that I loved to wear that was my son's, who gave it over to me because it came from my father. And he decided it wasn't really his fashion statement at that time. He felt it was better fit on my head, and I think he liked giving it over to me, as my son would. Now, my son lives abroad, so I don't have my son to go and stay at. I don't have my spouse to go and be with, because she's moved on in life. Now, I'm talking about real things. When we go through a loss or a divorce, we're looking for who loves us. Well, there's different types of love. There's love that helps us stay fit in our finances. There's love that helps us stay sound in our mind. And there's love that just says, I'm going to send you something every so often so that you know, no matter where you're traveling to, no matter where you're exploring to figure out where your life should really be, that you are loved by me. Those gifts might be silly in order for you to play with your children. Those gifts might be wise in order for you to learn something about loss or develop a different way to approach life. Those things might be wonderful at a Christmas time when you don't have enough to put around the Christmas tree, and those things might be full of love, honor, and regard, and even a marriage proposal if you're wise enough to get it. Now, when I talk about these things, I'm talking about perspective. You see, in homelessness, we have to have shelter, and a sheltered place is a place that keeps you warm when it's cold and cool when it's hot. It's also a place that we know that no one's going to enter in without our permission and take things from our other aspects of shelter, which are our dressers, our bags, our drawers, and any other way of box or anything that we keep our possessions in, even a storage locker. When I'm talking about other aspects of homelessness, we're talking about transportation. My lawful ride was taken from me in an illicit manner. My ride had nothing to do with the reason that I ended up for a few days in jail because my lawyer failed to produce a with stay, if you will, because the reality was that the people that I was supposed to meet with never met with me. Interesting enough, while I was visiting a Arby's restaurant in Noblesville, that voicemail system that would have proved those people did not show up on time for my life and caused me this difficulty in my life was removed from me. Someone hacked the system in that Arby's or outside that Arby's and deleted my rights to that account. Isn't that interesting? Now, when I talk about these things, I talk about them honestly, that I literally am being hit on a regular basis by law enforcement and others. It's now to the point of every 2 days, they wake me up in the middle of my slumber. Whether I'm sleeping in the middle of the night, like most people, or whether I've fallen asleep just waiting for a store to open, they bother me. They bother you, too, I guess, because it shouldn't just be me that they do this to. I mean, after all, no one is allowed to be fatigued in the land, right? No one is allowed to be tired from sports practice. No one's allowed to be fatigued in their elderly age. No one's allowed to sit on their rollator that have seats on them or on a chair that they produce because they know how hard it is to stand a long period of time. I've met many elderly people in my lifetime where my parents lived in independent living that literally had a chair in a cane. I thought that was fascinating. I thought that was awkward to walk with, but it was fascinating. Now, in my life, I carry my hunter's stool because it's lightweight, I can sling it over my shoulder, I can slide it into a pouch, and I utilize it because I am older and I am literally walking everywhere now. I have walked between Fishers and Noblesville. Now someone else can look on a map to see how many miles that is. I've walked there in the middle of the day, I've walked there in the middle of the night. I go when the Lord says to go. But openly, I have a right to walk. We do have the privilege of walking in America. There are sidewalks, although many are debris-filled, and full of rocks from the road and the cars and the trucks that go pummeling by. But the reality is transportation is essential to a human being's adult life. Our children, our teenagers, are viable enough in their health that they can ride a bicycle. It's what we provide them. We teach them the rules of the road through using a cycle. Then as they get a little bit more mature, they might move into a moped or a scooter or a motorcycle for some of them. But eventually, they all need a vehicle. And why is that? Because vehicles provide social capabilities, they provide movement for our lives, and they provide the access to employment that we need to be able to drive to our work. Now, we have plenty of foreigners here and others that don't have a vehicle for one reason or another, and they walk. Or they take the local transit, which is sort of odd that you have to spend 2 weeks in advance to know where you're going to be in your employment, which is not always possible, in order to hitch a ride with them for $3 a pop. We clearly need something better because our only other option is a taxi, which is usually cost prohibitive for most people. Yes, there are Uber cards that you can purchase a gift card to help someone get around, which is wonderful. And some organizations are very kind. They will help someone get somewhere without a real cost to them whatsoever. It's a loving thing they do. But in life, we have moments of time to say, hey, I care about you. I'm going to loan you this vehicle, or I'm going to give you a lift when it's time because you need that lift. I have things coming up that I've got to figure out how to get to, and I certainly can walk. I have walked the distance from Noblesville all the way downtown Indianapolis. I literally have done that. I almost killed myself in that possibility. I definitely destroyed my calves in that day, but I had to. I had no other choice. And I was lugging stuff that was too hard to get up on a bus. Now, in life, we have moments of time to help people. We are either a perpetrator of promise and profitability for people, or we're a perpetrator of disbelief and discomfort. When I talk about perpetration, that's what I'm really meaning. I mean, if you're walking by someone who is sitting on the side of the road, don't be calling police on their life. It's not your lawful right to create a litigation problem for that individual. If they've chosen to sit down, they've chosen to sit down because they're probably tired. Do you not get tired in your life? If you get tired and you have a home to go home to, wonderful. If you get tired and you want to sit on one of the community benches, good luck finding one that's comfortable. There's only a handful in the community that are actually comfortable for two purposes. One, for seating for a long period of time waiting for your ride, who might be coming to pick you up as a part of their errands of the day. Or two, one to actually slumber on, to take a quick nap on. You see, we're so out of touch with the rest of the world. In other parts of the world, they actually give people siestas during a certain part of the day because they know people get fatigued and they know the human body needs rest. And they know that the mind needs rest in order to be functioning properly. Well, today I was super tired. I had done a lot of walking the day before. I had done a lot of stressful things. And openly, I had the right to fall asleep seated on my stool. The person who woke me didn't really have the right to wake me. I would have woken when I was ready to wake, when I was done resting. We have to get back to the point of people's rights. Do we have the right to harass someone? No, we don't. Do we have the right to steal from someone? No, we don't. Do we have the right to demoralize someone? No, we don't. Do we have the right to take anything at all from them in this world? No, we don't. And yet, we have people who, in their minds, are so ill that they think that they do. This is where political schemes have to come into play. We have some marvelous candidates coming into the world and right now in the political climate saying, hey, it's time to get back to loving on people. It's time to get back to helping people. It's time to get back to being little superheroes with permission in the lives of others. Now, when I'm talking about homelessness, I'm also talking about food, the provision of food. There's a lot of food pantries in the communities sometimes. Sometimes there's only one food pantry in one community, but in another there might be 10. The only challenge we have is that sometimes those food pantries don't check the dates on the goods that they get. Sometimes those places become liable because they didn't keep something refrigerated long enough that they didn't pack it on ice while it was waiting to be picked up by people who might need it, and that creates foodborne illnesses. That can create diarrhea, can create all sorts of things in a person's body, creating for them a medical health situation that might cost them money. When we're thinking about food pantries, we have to think about ways to do that better. Canned goods are essential, but as we get into the summer months, if we've got an outdoor food pantry, like many churches do, which is pretty amazing, we have to make sure that there's protein in those pantries, not just the stuff we don't feel like using in our own homes. Nobody's going to sit there and eat a bunch of pumpkin pie mix. Not only is it not cooked and it's raw, it'll blow right through an individual. We know this from science. What I'm really talking about is we have to have products in cans like tuna and pork and beef and chicken in single allotments. If there's a family, then there might be a larger can. But not everybody who's homeless travels with a can opener because of today's opportunity to have a pop-top can. There's also other ways to stock up one of those places with little Vienna wieners or sausages or barbecued ones so that they have a little bit of kick to them, not at all. Not many people can really handle spicy food. Many of our foreigners can, but they can afford to add their own hot sauce to those things. We can't afford to take hot sauce out of something. Now, when I'm talking about the aspect of food, sometimes people give pasta, and that's not appropriate to an outdoor facility. Why? Because worms and other things can crawl into the cardboard boxes. They also don't last in the moisture of the rain. We have to be common sense about a lot of these things. Packed in plastic is fine, but eventually the box deteriorates, and then you have a mess, not being able to read the directions. The truth is, in a food pantry, the best thing we could possibly do would be to buy gift cards. The trouble is that sometimes employees steal money off people's gift cards, and that's a real problem. It puts the homeless person at risk going to the store if there's no receipt proving that there was a purchase. The best of the gift cards will always give an information back of how much money is left and remaining on a gift card. A gift card is also incredibly easy for a truly homeless person, not just an impoverished person, but a homeless person who has no home to carry. Carrying canned goods all day long is difficult. Most food pantries are only thinking about stocking some up for the week. It's because they're thinking about feeding the impoverished. The impoverished still have a home, they still have a car, they still have a way around. The problem in Hamilton County is that people don't see homelessness. They think it's such a shocking thing to see it that they don't know what to do with themselves. The truth is, most people are a paycheck or two away from homelessness. We don't have lots of nest eggs in the bank. It's true for most people who are a single provider of an income in a household. If there's two incomes, then possibly, if we're living carefully within a budget and means, then we have extra money set aside for retirement, for those old years, that $1 million that we all know we have to have in order to retire. If we don't have that, if we don't have a retirement package, if we don't have those opportunities, how can we possibly go on in life into our elder years? So when I'm talking about homelessness, I'm talking about it in a way that makes sense to most people when I talk to them one-on-one. That if they don't truly have a full retirement until their 80s or 90s, they might not have planned for the fact that God might not take them home until their 80s or 90s. I know that in my own mother's life, she's at 83, 84 already, maybe even 85. I don't know. I can't keep up with her birth dates. But in truth, she lives in a posh place at 3 times the rent of an apartment today. That's because my father provided well. I'm not saying this to brag because I'm an impoverished state. She lives in luxury. How lucky for her. The truth is, at moments in time, there would have been an opportunity for her to help me, but my siblings won't allow it. And they have monkeyed with my stuff, so I don't want to be anywhere near them. I don't like being near liars of the land. I don't like being near people who think they have the right to take my rights away and interfere with my right of freedom of movement under civil liberties law. You see, in life, we have forgotten what the U.S. Constitution stands for. That's a problem we've got to take care of right now. We have to change that right now. The politicians coming into office are starting to get that message. It's time to go back to love, peace, honor, dignity, and regard in America. Thanks for listening.